Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. The first item on the agenda is to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill at stage one, and we'll be taking evidence in two panels. Our first panel this morning is Paul Little, Vice Chair of the College's Principals Group, College of Scotland, Matthew Sweeney, Policy Manager, Children and Young People, COSLA, David Belsey, Assistant Secretary, EIS, Diane Stockton, Consultant in Public Health Scotland, John Edward, Director, the Scottish Council of Independent Schools, and Alistair Sim, Director of University Scotland. Now, Paul Little, Matthew Sweeney, David Belsey, and Diane Stockton are joining us remotely. Good morning to all of you, and I can now see your faces on the screen, which is good. And John and Alistair are with us in the committee room. So good morning to you all, and thank you in advance for the evidence that you are going to share with us. Unfortunately, time is limited this morning, so please do not feel that you must answer every question that is posed, and I will try my best to bring people in, but I have to ensure that the session concludes by 10:30 at the latest. Any outstanding matters can be followed up in writing. So let me start the questioning off. Let me go first of all to Alistair. Alistair, in your evidence, written evidence to the committee this morning, you say in the first paragraph, at no point has the Scottish Government had to use the emergency powers in the existing Coronavirus Act 2020 with regard to higher education. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. We've worked in a very successful partnership approach with Scottish Government within the overall framework that Scottish Government has set to make sure that universities are successfully managing the risks and successfully supporting students through the, you know, frankly, the very disruptive time that they have had. I think that partnership arrangement has worked very well, and I think you know, it is a model for what should be done going forwards.
And you say that you're concerned that the bill gives ministers responsibility to make regulations at a level of detail that cannot competently be done by government. Maybe you can explain why you say that.
Yes, of course. I mean, I think if government is to take emergency powers, you know, and I can understand why government feels that emergency powers may need to be in a statute book, I think they should be framed a bit differently from this. I think the way that these powers are framed, this basically reproduces the Coronavirus Act 2020, which was produced, you know, in a tearing hurry at the beginning of a crisis. So I think we've got the opportunity to step back now and think perhaps more profoundly about what is necessary and if things are necessary. And, you know, from my point of view, it would be much better to have a framework where ministers are setting out the general requirements, but where institutions are deciding the really granular stuff, you know, who should be coming into university in person to complete their studies, what buildings should be open, what research projects need to continue, when people are doing assessments and how they're being assessed. That's stuff that really needs detailed consideration at institutional level and consultation with staff and students, and that frankly no government has got a detailed local knowledge to be able to do that. So we're actually trying to help here. We're trying to say, look, there's an alternative framework here that will achieve your objectives but not draw you down into a level of granular detail that you're just not, you know, no government is competent to do.
And is it basically what you're basically saying is that guidance has worked during the last 2 years, so there's no need to legislate impermanence in these areas? Is that it?
I think guidance has worked and partnership has worked very well, so we don't see an absolute need to legislate. But if government is, you know, absolutely minded to legislate, I think they should do so in a way that is much more with the grain of what's worked, where they can set out general requirements and make sure that the granular implementation of that is done by the people on the ground who know how to do it.
You have a specific reference in your submission to us about admissions. Can you just explain what that part of the evidence is?
Yes. I mean, I think, you know, from discussions with Scottish Government officials, I think looking at, I think it's 8.5D particularly, in the bill, it does get into the business of, in the words of the bill, requiring specified people to attend a specified educational establishment. And, you know, from my conversations with the Scottish Government, I think, you know, part of the sort of well-intentioned objective of this section is that, you know, for instance, if one university was closed, people might be moved to a course in another university. You know, I can see the good intention there, but actually, I don't think government can just move people around like that, because you don't know whether the course they're going to has got capacity. You don't know whether the course they're going to meets their academic needs. So again, it's just I think there's quite a lot of good intentions behind this bill, but it actually draws government into making decisions that it can't really competently do, and that institutions may not competently be able to implement.
And this is true of student accommodation as well, because there's regulation in the bill about that. What's your response to that?
The partnership approach has worked very well here. Diane Stockton from Public Health Scotland has been, you know, at the core of that, among others. And I think if there's an emergency, it should be the university's management in consultation with staff and students who are taking the action to decide exactly how students should be supported through the crisis, and very much in consultation with the Public Health Scotland and the Local Health Board, rather than that to be a matter of ministerial direction. I mean, government just does not know the detailed, granular information on the ground to enable it to do that as well as it should be done.
So give us the guidance and we'll act responsibly. That's your message.
Well, that's been how it's worked over the past couple of years. I think if there has to be legislation, go with the grain of that, because it's been a successful approach.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I can turn to Paul Little. And in your evidence, Paul Little, you say, on the basis of the experience, this is the experience of the college operations during the pandemic, we'd advise the intended provisions which have been proposed within the bill are not required. Maybe you can expand on that for us, please. Why are they not required?
Well, many of you know I'm principal of the largest college in Scotland. I'll make some reference to that, but I'm also a member of the ministerial advisory group and indeed the subsequent COVID recovery group. So I got a real side insight into all the planning and all the response at a sector-wide and indeed a national level. I believe that the regulations as proposed are completely unnecessary. They are central planning overreach, and they do not address harms one and harms three and four, nor do they in any way mitigate the lost learning that we are presently trying to support, nor the mental health challenges. If you will, to support what Alistair just said, my institution closed one full week before we had any advice in government to do so. And during the entire 2 years, we were ahead of the overwhelmed officials. In fact, we were able to share and support them during this time. So in the challenge that we faced was the particular practical learning that colleges have, the practical education, the need for access to specialist facilities. And I think the understanding of that was limited at the centre. Ultimately, on the front line, we're best placed to support students, support their mental health, support their digital learning, and indeed to support their practical learning. And we had a good example of that. And in Save Glasgow College, not only did we support the local community, but we were supporting care sector, the SME sector. We, in fact, were supporting the maritime sector. Many of the vaccines and food that came to Scotland came via our ships. And my particular institution had 245 cadet officers at sea during the pandemic. So we were very much really on the front line in making that response. And we actually had detailed plans later on to help upskill and reskill. But what this particular bill doesn't do is it doesn't deal with any of the aftermath or any of the urgencies. Presently, the college sector is facing over £50 million of potential cuts. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the potential for a future pandemic when we're dealing with the real crisis in education.
We're talking about the wrong things.
Well, I would prefer, and I'm sure many of my education colleges would prefer to talk about how we can mitigate against lost learning, how we can support the very real self-harm and attempted suicides amongst our student population as they deal with the mental health. The long shadow of COVID has actually been further complicated by the implications of Brexit, by a decade of austerity, by indeed any of the instability that we presently find in Eastern Europe. And those are very real pressures that colleges are facing. 26 colleges right across Scotland or well over 500,000 learners. It's a clear and present challenge to us now. We have already demonstrated that the college sectors had an agile response to a pandemic with no such planning and no such legislation. I think the 2 years of learning will stand us in good stead. Distracted by this present set of regulations won't allow us the concentration that we're going to need, as I said, to deal with that lost learning, and indeed to deal with real day-to-day learning, which is our fundamental responsibility.
And Paul, you've made these points directly to ministers, have you? You're part of the ministerial guidance you mentioned. You're involved with government. You've made these points directly to the ministers, have you?
Ministers and officials are very well aware of these points, and we have a very good and strong partnership during the pandemic in supporting ministers and indeed officials and all the public agencies to do that. So they're very well aware of that. I think I would also add that just yesterday we published the economic transformation proposals, but 2 years ago, 1 month before the pandemic, we were asked by ministers to publish the blueprint for the economic transformation of colleges at that time, what was known as the Cumber for Lit report. We're now past the 2 year anniversary and that hasn't been implemented. So that's just another example that as we replace one priority to another priority, perhaps those priorities that are more recent are less of a priority than the new ones.
Okay, that's very clear. I'm going to turn now to David Belsey. And David, I want to quote part of your submission to you and ask you to expand on it. The EIS believes that extending such powers to extending such powers to issue regulations indefinitely could upset the balance of power between local authorities and the Scottish Government. Can you explain that, please?
Thank you, Convener. I think the submission to the Parliament regarding the bill sets out the concern the EIS has that whilst we welcome government powers to close schools during a pandemic and the regulation and the statute behind that to exist, were those powers to be extended indefinitely, as is suggested by the bill, then it gives a degree of power and oversight over schools and thereby over local authorities that does not currently exist. And whilst the intention today is to protect and maintain education provision, in the future it may have unintended consequences, because there is a very delicate balance between the role of government in delivering strategic oversight and funding for education and the role of local authorities in carrying out and delivering education on the ground. And the government's previous work in the previous education bill looked at that balance between government and local authorities and decided to keep the current balance. But that's, I think, what we are setting out there. We do believe that within a public health emergency, that government should have these powers for, in effect, taking strategic control over school closures and reopenings.
So, if I may. Is that because during the last 2 years there was a breakdown in the competence of the ability of local authorities to make those decisions for themselves? Because in your submission you say you would like to have. The EIS would like to have seen an explicit delegation to local authorities to also make decisions to close schools, to move to remote platforms in interest. So you're basically saying in your submission that you feel that local authorities, with guidance from the centre, should be making these decisions on the basis of delegated authority, which they already have. Is that correct?
No. What we're saying is that at the moment, the opening and closings of schools remain within the power of the government, acting with the public health authorities. And there is actually very limited ability for a local authority to close a school. So you had some schools in Glasgow which had hundreds of pupils ill, which had large numbers of teachers ill, but because they could get in supply teachers to physically staff and by merging classes and so forth, they kept the school open. Because the local authority, as we understand it, didn't have the lawful authority to close the school on public health grounds on its own basis. From what we're saying is that government should have strategic oversight and should make those decisions, but also that local authorities should be able to close a school and move to online learning as well. So we are looking for greater flexibility. That's not a reflection on government's either ability or its right to make strategic decisions for Scotland as a whole.
Right. I think I understand that. What you're arguing for is what I said, that you feel the local authorities should have that power. I must confess, I thought local authorities already could close schools.
Not for public health grounds, only if they can't physically staff a school, then they can close it down. But in terms, if they want to close it down on public health grounds, they've got to get permission from the local public health authorities and effectively the Scottish Government.
But basically,
so when we were looking to close schools before Christmas 2020, in order to protect staff and pupils, local authorities were telling us they couldn't close schools down early before Christmas because of the way in which the powers were set out.
That's very interesting. Michael Mara, do you want to come in on schools?
Can I have a brief supplementary I think the question to Paul Little and Alistair Sim. I was in the first instance, I was quite intrigued by, could you say what, perhaps Paul, first of all, what didn't happen in the last 2 years that government wanted to happen? I mean, it seems to me that if they're asking for more power to direct, what were the things that didn't happen? What's the problem they're trying to solve here?
Well, I'm at a bit of a loss to understand that, because such was the very close working relationship and almost real-time, day-to-day, and 24-hour accessibility, that there was, in my opinion, there was no problems that were left unresolved during the emergency response. Problems that were left unresolved, whereas the response was going to the next stage, such as the lost learning and the mental health, and the understanding that different institutions have different requirements. There really wasn't a fully realisation that the nature of college education, where over perhaps three quarters it was about practical learning, practical instruction, workshop, that wasn't properly fully understood in that regard. But I felt that the response was a very good response between the government and the colleges, and indeed the wider university and tertiary sector. In fact, I would argue that actually it was very much a lifeline to communities, very much a lifeline to businesses in that. So I wasn't aware either as a college principal or indeed as a member of those advisory groups that we were feeling in that response. Yeah. So that's why I believe this is completely unnecessary, because I don't believe it will address the harms in 3 and 4, which the social harms or indeed the economic harms. And in fact, there was a very late realisation that they were real and present harms as part of that response.
Thanks, Paul. Alistair, you understand my characterisation of this, yeah?
In a sense, my answer is really exactly the same as Paul Little's. The emergency powers that you know, in the Coronavirus Act 2020 that you know this bill effectively mirrors did not need to be used because the partnership approach was successful.
So you didn't feel at any point that there was government or ministers were asking you and your colleagues in universities to do something, and the universities were just saying no, we can't do it, and now this kind of more of a power take to the centre to make that happen, you know, to compel you. You don't recall conversations along those lines.
That wasn't required. Obviously, you know, through the group that Paul refers to, there's a constant dialogue going on between the sector, the trade unions, the student movement, and government about what should be done. And that's a forum in which different views are tested. And you know, usually you come to a consensus. But at no point did push come to shove, and emergency powers have to be used.
Okay. Thank you. I must substantive questions.
Thank you. Before you do so, of course. I just want to get my head straight here. I wanted to just one last question to David from the EIS. Is the EIS argument the opposite of what this bill does then? Are you saying that powers need to be given from government to local authorities? Is that the rebalancing that you're talking about?
No. No. What we're talking about is that local authorities should have the powers to close schools on public health grounds as well.
That's government. What I'm saying.
But instead of...
Yes, but that's what I'm saying. your argument is that that power should be given to local authorities.
Yes, they should have the ability
to close
the school.
And they don't currently have it, which is the opposite of what the intent of this bill is, which is to bring powers to the centre.
Well, the bill is, in many ways, setting out the regulatory and statute bedrock, from which I imagine that they will probably operate in a different way in reality, along the way that Paul and Alistair have explained. In other words, there is a way of making universities and colleges follow education continuity directives at present, but they don't do so. They have followed a partnership approach. So what we're saying here is that government is putting the statutory bedrock down for continuing the powers they have now. Yeah. But what we're saying is, fine, we've got no problems with that, but we would also like, in addition, not a local flexibility for councils to make, on grounds of public health, not simply staffing, the ability to close schools. Well, now, we don't see that as a contradiction. We simply see it as something that is complementary.
I've got half the committee that want to come in, but before I bring the committee in, Matthew Sweeney wants to come in as well. Matthew, please, and then we'll go to my colleagues.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to sort of come in with some of where we are around this. I think the first thing we'd say is I agree with some of the discussion we've had so far. Local authorities don't have the power. However, under the 1975 regulations, the appropriate person, I think, is the legal term within a health board. Most often, I think, in practice, the Director of Public Health does have that ability to sort of do it on that school-by-school basis. Now, I think what we're talking about in terms of this legislation is around what happens if we're in a situation like in March 2020, when there is need to take sort of national-level action on that. And I don't think that there has been a clear legislative vehicle to do that before the Emergency Act. And I think what part of the things that we're quite mindful of is that the International Council of Education Advisors have been clear that pandemics may become more frequent in the future. And I think that's why we sort of see somewhat of a need around this. Now, I think in terms of what my members are interested in, there is potentially, I think, perhaps quite different in the space of schools compared to our colleagues in further and higher education, is that obviously there's a duty for us to provide education to every single child within our area. And therefore, there was a legal protection that was given to our members by the waiving of some of the duties through the use of the continuity directions. And that meant that, whilst I think some of the mitigations may have been and closures may have been controversial, there was an additional sort of support and comfort, I think, that local authorities had in being giving the cover around the national direction based on strong partnership working. And that being very important. And just
but do you need? But do you need? But do you need legislation to do that? Given the fact that there seems to be a pretty robust framework already around authorities and that you've just described, why do we need new legislation then?
I think that that's the difference is if we're in a situation where there is a need, and when we're in a new virus, is in the same way that we had with coronavirus, where there was a need to take action on a nationwide level, it can be. Much more, I think, makes sense to be where we are. It also brings in the additional resources and support that that was achieved through close working with government. But I think what I would be clear about is we are really clear that we need the bill to be changed as is to make sure that there is close engagement and consultation with local authorities before any direction is created.
Right. Oliver Mundell and then Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to go back to EIS, to David, with really just a question whether that same kind of discretion should be given to head teachers within schools. I think it's well and good, saying that the local authority should have the power to shut a school on health grounds. But the example you cite in Glasgow, other experiences I've seen in my own constituency, often these are difficult judgment calls, and surely the person who knows the school, the young people, the community, best, should have a say in that decision too.
I think head teachers should have a say, but the final decision should be taken by the local authority.
Okay, Willie Rennie.
What did I do? David, I'm curious about this because surely it doesn't matter who makes the final call, because the professional advice from the public health officials will be the same no matter who's making the decision. So why is it necessary to have multiple people legally entitled to close the school when the advice is going to be the same? Surely the issue here is making sure that we've got the right advice about how to proceed and clear authority and partnership to make it happen. Why is it necessary to have multiple bodies making the call?
I think, as Paul Matthew set out a few minutes ago, having a national ability to close all schools in response to a national emergency seems a worthwhile lever to have. Sometimes the events within a particular community or school are developed in such a way that we believe that school should have been closed. A number of schools, to be honest with you, should have been closed, and we put our requests, our views to the local authority, and the local authority says to us that we cannot legally close that school on public health grounds. It might be 400 kids off. There might be kids sitting in a school hall with supply teachers. And strange enough, some pupils may even benefit from having a remote teaching at home. But they are unable to, the local authorities are unable to close that school because they don't have the authority to do so. And what we are saying is that we believe the local authority should have the flexibility, in addition to the powers the government would have under this bill, that the local authority should also have the ability to close that school.
Michael, I'm going to come back to you in a moment, but I'm going to bring in Ross and then James Dornan. Ross.
Thanks, Convener. It's just particularly to go back to some of the points that Alistair made. I understand entirely the line of argument that the partnership approach taken in this pandemic was successful, therefore why would we wish to alter that? But surely that's on the assumption that the people involved next time on either side will be as reasonable and as willing to cooperate as they were last time. And we generally don't make laws on the basis of the individuals round the table at any particular time. These are laws that are proposed to be there on a permanent basis. Should we be pursuing this line of argument that partnership worked this time, therefore it will definitely work next time? Is the point of this not to have that backup option in place if those partnerships break down?
Can I come in there? I think if there is to be legislation, it's got to be legislation that works, and that's really what we're saying in our paper, that if you are to have emergency powers legislation, have emergency powers legislation that goes with the grain of what has already been proven to work. One can conceive ministers, for instance, taking emergency powers that enable them to say at a level of generality, look, there's a really severe public health emergency. The access to in-person provision at universities has to be restricted. And then, for instance, students are prioritised who are about to sit their final exams or who've got practical learning or are about to graduate from the health disciplines and go and actually address the crisis. But if ministers have the power under emergency legislation to see that at the generality, it's got to be up to institutions with their staff and students to implement that at the level of granularity that's needed, considering what students need to come in, what courses need to continue, what experiments need to continue, what buildings need to be open. So, our problem with the way that the emergency powers are framed here is that it actually draws ministers into making those decisions that need to be made locally within an overall framework set by government. So, if there has to be emergency legislation, let it be emergency legislation that works by giving ministers and government their proper role in setting out overall requirements and giving the managers with staff and students at institutional level the real granular responsibility for making the decisions that implement that.
Do you think the government's intention in bringing this forward is to, on a wholesale basis, make decisions on the granular level you're talking about? Because my assumption about the intention here is that, of course, the partnership approach that we've pursued up until now would be the preference, but it can't be guaranteed that every partner is going to be cooperative in the future. And the universities themselves were a very good example of that level of cooperation with government. Some of the private student accommodation providers, for example, were not. Surely it's better for the government to have that ability to intervene on a granular level, not with the intention of doing so wholesale across the country in every institution, in every instance, but in the instances where there is someone who is not cooperating with, whether it's local public health teams, the local authority, Scottish Government directly. We can't guarantee that everyone's going to want to take a partnership approach next time. Surely the government needs the ability to intervene on a granular level if and when that's necessary, even if it's regrettable that that's the case.
I think if the government takes general powers to require emergency things to be done during a public health emergency and a particular institution or a particular provider of purpose-built student accommodation isn't doing it, they can take them to court. They have remedies there. They can just get in there and insist that it is done. But I don't think it's for government to get in there and say a particular building has to be closed or to prescribe the access arrangements to a particular building, or to say, you know, exactly course by course who should still be coming in to get some in-person provision, because I simply don't think government is competent to do that. That's no criticism of any particular administration. It's just drawing government deeply into areas where government cannot know enough at the granular level to exercise those powers well.
I'm conscious this was a supplement. Just one more follow-up, convener. Sure. Thanks. So just on that point of the government's ability to, I mean, not just the government, anyone's ability to take anyone to court, but in this case specifically, the government's ability to take an institution to court, the context for this here is if we face another pandemic that forces us into making decisions on an hour-by-hour basis, and with the best will in the world, pursuing court action cannot result in a response as quickly as you might like in the case of a public health emergency. Mm-hmm. Sure, that's exactly what we're talking about here, is the on the day or in the space of a couple of days being faced with having to make decisions so urgently that if the partnership approach doesn't work, by the time you've gone to court to get it resolved, the situation has either got markedly worse in an avoidable way or it has not. Yeah. Is this not about... This is about reflecting the urgency of a future pandemic. Well,
I think the same is true, however you exercise those powers. Even if ministers took those granular powers, I mean, they may well find that they're actually not able to be exercised on the ground, and you might end up with a dispute which has to get sorted in court, one would hope not. But I think if the law, you know, if ministers frame emergency powers, you know, in our view, better than they're currently framed, because this was all done in a rush in March 2020. So it should, you know, I think this is a time for thoughtful reflection on what works. So, you know, if ministers were to set, you know, take a framework that allows them to prescribe the general requirements and for those to be locally implemented, that's the law. People have just got to go on and do it.
Thanks very much. That was useful.
Right, very good. And now we've got James Dornan.
James. Thank you, convener. Alistair Sim and Paul Little have made a lot about this legislation being unnecessary, but given that they've just told us how they've been able to work in partnership during the 2020, when the 2020 powers were in vogue, then why is there a problem with this? I mean, they obviously... except, and this has fallen on from Ross's, I suppose, because the government must surely have powers to act quickly when required. But you've got to be able to, in this case, you must be trusting the government, because you've just worked with them for a number of years with the 2020 legislation. So what's the panic for and your responses for this? These powers?
If I may come in, I mean, just to quote exactly from our submission, it actually says we recognise the case of ministers to have emergency powers in the event of another severe new public health crisis, even though we hope these will never have to be used. But if there are to be emergency powers, we want these to be operable in a way that protects public health and takes account of the four harms and will be operable on the ground. That's what we're trying to achieve here. We're not actually having a dispute from first principles with government. We're trying to help government and parliament to frame emergency provisions if government wishes there to be emergency provisions in a way that we believe will be better operable than what's here, which reflects what was done in a rush in the Coronavirus Act 2020 at the very beginning of the crisis.
But your evidence suggested that's worked well. that the government has been working with you. So what makes you suggest or makes you think that if this legislation comes through, that the government will stop working well with the universities and the colleges?
Oh, we would certainly hope that they would, but you know, taking up points that have already been made in this meeting, you know, the law is the law. We have to make sure that it's something that is operable. You know, whoever happens to be in our various positions when the next emergency hits us.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Diane Stockton.
Yeah, I was just going to come in on explain how it works when there's a significant outbreak in a school. So what will happen, or what has happened, is that there would be a meeting of the local public health team and the school senior staff, the head staff and local authority representatives, and that's where the discussion would occur around you know, whether the school should shut. So that's I take the point of what David's been saying, but that there should be a comprehensive discussion, and from the public health side we would be considering, you know, the wider harms, the wider picture in shutting a school on public health grounds. So it's quite unusual to shut the school, to schools to have been shut on public health grounds in the pandemic so far. So they have been shut for reasons of staffing more often. Thanks.
No, that's very useful. That's very useful. Bob Doris.
Thank you, convener. Alistair Sims' comment earlier about the mirroring of the 2020 emergency coronavirus powers and the powers that the Scottish Government is seeking to take in this bill. I think there was an equivalence drawn, and I'm just wondering if the 2020 powers were fit for purpose and had partnership working, meaning that they never actually had to be exercised with universities and colleges, what's the difference with this set of powers?
Well, I think the 2020 powers indeed never needed to be used. I think we would doubt whether, if they had to be used, whether they were actually genuinely operable, because, you know, what's in Schedule 16 and 17 of the Coronavirus Act 2020, you know, does get ministers into this extremely granular level of deciding who should be coming on a course, what buildings should be open, what buildings should be closed, what your opening times are, when you should set assessments. And, you know, this, I think government, if government had reached for those emergency powers, they might have found them actually quite problematic to use, which is why we're trying to help government and parliament here to find a framework that actually will be more robust and operable, and that will go with the grain of, you know, 2 years' experiment of what actually works.
Mm. I'm interested to know what criticisms you made at the time, and my apologies, Mr. Sim, if you did make criticisms at the time, it'd be very informative to the committee. In 2020, what criticisms did you make of the emergency powers at that point? And I think you're conceding, constructively so, that there is the need for emergency powers, a framework, emergency power, to put in place now also. What changes would you make to the current proposals?
Well, I think the emergency powers went through Parliament in 4 days in 2020, so there really wasn't an opportunity for
a stakeholder. But 2020 lasted a year, Mr. Sim. Did you make you constant conversations with the government? You said how constructive, yes, your dialogue was with the government. I assume you must have mentioned to the government what parts of those powers you were unhappy with at some point during 2020.
It never came up because they never had to be reached for. You know, certainly when those powers went through, you know, we you know, there was not really an opportunity actually for effective parliamentary or stakeholder scrutiny, which is why I think it's important to take the time now to make sure that if there are to be emergency powers, that they are crafted well and are operable, rather than just reproducing what was done, you know, frankly, in a rush in 2020. And what we've suggested in our paper here is an alternative approach, which we think actually government would find more operable, which is to get ministers, you know, give ministers the powers. If they're to have emergency legislation, you clearly should have powers to say at a general level, you know, here are the sort of restrictions that need to be imposed to control a public health emergency, and here at a general level are sort of exceptions that need to be made to provide continuity of education, to look after students' welfare, to look after educational needs, and to require the people on the ground to make the granular decisions to implement that.
And presumably, if the government needed further emergency powers, we could have a repetition of what happened in 2020 with the four-day turnaround of legislation.
Yeah, of course.
But Mr. Simms just said that 4 days wasn't enough. So the scrutiny we're having just now is a lot longer than 4 days, convener. But Mr. Simms, that's helpful to know that you confirm you didn't raise any concerns at all at any point in 2020. Mr. Little, did you raise concerns in 2020 about the powers?
Well, because of the good partnership work, and we didn't have concerns, but colleges have experienced overreach. Previous legislation, the Post 16 Bill, that's reduced.
But we're talking about this legislation, Mr. Little, so could you stick to this legislation? In 2020, did you raise concerns?
Well, the concern would be that institutional autonomy will be further eroded.
Did you raise those concerns in 2020?
We raised concerns of the throughput of officials who had to enact this legislation. As I said earlier, the officials were overwhelmed and there was such a throughput of officials. If there is not the institutional autonomy, you will not, in the next pandemic, have an agile response. You will not have the community response, the economic response, the educational response, indeed, the safety response that you're going to require, particularly in my own situation, a very large metropolitan economy and a very large metropolitan institution. If you receive weekly or even daily diktat because you're trying to create a bureaucratic response to what actually should be an agile response, then there's a real danger that we will not have as an effective response as we had in 2020.
But Mr. Little, can I just check?
Sorry, I'm going to move the question on now. I'm going to move the question.
Does Mr. Little really believe this bill is a daily diktat? Because I think he loses credibility there.
Thank you, Bob. We're going to move on. I want to bring in David Belsey.
EIS is the sole recognised trade union for FE lecturers, and we're recognising the HE sector too. So we too have been together with Paul and Alistair on the Advanced Learning COVID Recovery Group. I'd like to make a couple of observations around what University of Scotland is saying around its plans. At the moment, what the government has done is put itself in a position where it's got the ability to use statutory powers, but it's then issued and worked in partnership to develop detailed guidance, prescribed guidance for further and higher education, together with all the representatives and the major stakeholders of the two sectors. I think that process, or the EIS believes that process, has worked well, particularly in colleges. Colleges, I think, have delivered the education in a quick, agile way and protected staff as well and students. And we've had very few problems across the college sector. The university sector has been slightly different. Some universities have been pushing the envelope and requiring our members to go in, even when there was a detailed prescribed F&HE guidance. And I think that on the whole, it's worked well. But the ability for the government to sit back and rely on statutory guidance if necessary, or statutory powers, I should say, if necessary, I think is welcome. Ultimately, I don't think the granularity that the University of Scotland is talking about, that the government would seem to wish, would be a factor. I don't think any government control individual buildings across the university estates, and we don't welcome that. But we do have concerns with what the University of Scotland is proposing, which is a general framework in which there is no trade union involvement at all at a local level. And it's talked about staff representatives. And it also talks about, and it loses the close amount of collaborative working that has been taking place over the 2 years, which we are keen to maintain. So I think that there needs to be the views of the workers within those two sectors, as well as simply the senior leadership.
And Paul Little.
I mean, I would just say that we were trying to get evidence-based policymaking, evidence-based legislation here, and what we find is in the college sector across 265,000 students, there's a 93% satisfaction or happiness rate with the colleges. So our response during this pandemic has been heightened. But in addition to that, we have demonstrated a constant partnership, a constant dialogue with ministers, with officials, with our partners and the trade unions and universities, indeed with community learning and development. You know, that 2 years of evidence is worth something remembering. And the leaders that have been experiencing that will still be leading the colleges if there's a further virus that emerges, or indeed the learning that we have got. We've captured that in writing, we've captured that for the next generation of leaders who may be unfortunate enough to face this experience. But, you know, the challenge is that you want your institutions to have an agile response. If you hamper that with unnecessary bureaucracy or indeed unnecessary overreach, then all you'll do is have everyone play safe and dumb down the response. And you don't want that.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I've been listening carefully. I think going back, you know, to the start of the pandemic, we all were willing to tolerate things that maybe we wouldn't have normally been comfortable with in legislation. But I think the question, you know, from what you're saying this morning, is whether things have moved on. And obviously, you know, partnership is important, but so too is proportionality. And I just wanted to clarify that really, from what you're saying, you know, you don't feel that this legislation is proportionate to the kind of scale of the task, or, you know, or the degree of emergency we face. And I'm happy to take comment from anyone.
Well, maybe we can bring John in, because he's been sitting very patiently there, and I worry that we haven't heard from you. John?
Yeah, I mean, on that point, our issue with the proposal is there are two issues on principle and one issue in practice. And the first issue on principle, which I'm surprised hasn't been mentioned at all this morning, is that my government and my parliament has already established a formal inquiry into COVID-19 under the leadership of Lady Poole. And it seems to me that if we're going to legislate subsequently to learn the lessons of COVID-19, we should wait to the public inquiry that is established particularly to learn the lessons of COVID-19 before we then start legislating for them, especially as we're not out of COVID-19 yet. So there's one, it seems to me there's a very, very sophisticated process to learn what's worked and what hasn't there. The other point of principle for us is a simple one, and it's slightly different, I recognise, from my other colleagues, is that our institutions are entirely autonomous. Independent in the name is a bit of a giveaway. So a piece of legislation that requires the trustees and the governors of independent institutions, whether mainstream or special needs, to do certain things, which they may or may not entirely agree with, I think needs a lot of scrutiny. And I go back on what everyone else has said. We haven't had any issue. I can think of one example in the last 2 years when we had a difference of opinion with the civil servants that we have worked extremely closely with, as we have with Public Health Scotland, infection control groups in public health, in NHS board and so on. And that was the isolation, extended isolation of boarding pupils in residences beyond what was required for other individuals. And we didn't see that as being proportionate or necessary. Indeed, the biggest risk that boarding school pupils from abroad ran was picking up infections in local communities. Every figure showed that they were in a safer place being inside than out. So we had no issues with the way it's done. And people have talked about the people's panic about this, opposing this proposal. There's no panic, just as there was no panic over the 2 years in terms of dealing with the measures put in place. Our schools, although entirely autonomous, all closed on exactly the same day as every local authority school, and they would do it again. So I don't, you know, the system works if that is the system. If it's not the system, then let's wait and see what the community says through the inquiry to decide what is. And the point on practicality is simply that what works for a small alternative school in the car park of Cameron Toll in Edinburgh does not work for a large residential school in the woods of Elgin. And therefore, having a government-level responsibility to do this, I think, does take us away a bit from which we see in, for instance, extreme weather situations. You know, if there is extreme weather in the east of Scotland, our schools in the west of Scotland do not shut. If there's extreme weather in one end of Aberdeen, our schools in the other end of Aberdeen don't necessarily shut. And it, to me, it's the same principle. Our schools have worked very, very closely with public health, very, very closely with the government, and have made the best of the appalling situation we've all been through for the last 2 years. And we simply don't understand the need for an obligation on us beyond the obligation that we have demonstrated to operate through the last 2 years, to keep the continuity of education, to try to stop attainment from dropping, to protect the mental health of our pupils. And in that respect, we would be more than happy for the next period to work with what we've got rather than seek to replace it with something else.
Thank you very much, John. That was very, very helpful. Now, finally, back to Michael Mara. Michael Mara has also been sitting patiently now for about half an hour.
No, I wanted to go to... I'm sure it is worth the wait, Michael. I wanted to go to Public Health Scotland. And it really was just to push on that point. You know, is in terms of building public trust and confidence, you know, moving forward in terms of encouraging people to continue to follow the guidance as we move into to the next sort of stage. You know, how important is proportionality? You know, how important is it that the legislation matches the situation and the level of, you know, the level of emergency and fear, you know, people feel across the country?
Who was that addressed to?
To Public Health Scotland.
Is
that something that's factored in how the public as a whole, how organisations feel, how decision makers feel? If the legislation that's on the statute books is out of step, you know, with the perceived risk, you know, and state of emergency, you know, they see us to be in.
Yeah, thanks, Oliver. So, so obviously communications really has become more and more important, especially during this Omicron stage, I would say, of the pandemic, as the perceived risks have reduced, and having kind of consistent messaging has become more and more important, I think, across sectors, across public health, across the government, in terms of the importance of the mitigations, the speed of reduction of mitigations, balancing the anxieties of some of the population as the mitigations are relaxed versus the speed that others want to see it relaxed. I think it's a very tricky balance. We constantly looking at the evidence.
Do you think something's gone wrong in that communication? You know, when you've got, you know, senior people within a wide range of organisations coming forward and effectively saying that the government legislation's, you know, an overreach, does that not break down, you know, some of the trust and partnership and confidence that's been built up over the last 2 years? Does that not put public health at risk?
My view on the communications is that it's been very consistent. So what different organisations are saying has been very consistent, and that very strong partnership working that the other witnesses have talked about has come through in terms of the consistent messaging that's been put across. But obviously, if that did break down and if different messages were coming from different sectors, then I think that would be a problem for public trust. But it's not so far. It feels to me that we've had very strong and consistent messaging around the key issues.
Michael Mara. Finally, Michael Mara.
Thank you, Camilla. I want to move on to Chapter 2, Part 2, regarding the consultations for changes to school estate and provision. I'll hopefully keep it reasonably brief. I think when these proposals first emerged, there was some concern that was certainly voiced to me regarding a kind of a power shift to central government. But really, this is about the consultation process and taking people's views on board. I know from the EIS submission that they believe that any moves to remove public meetings from that process for the consultations on whether a school should close permanently, this is in regards to, or move to be merged with another one. Could maybe the colleague from the EIS set out why they think that it's particularly important that those physical meetings are continued?
Thank you,
digital divide.
Sorry, I don't think we caught the start of that, of your answer, David, if you could maybe start.
Okay. there is a digital divide. Some people are able to join in online meetings whilst others are not. And for some people, it is easier to obtain printed materials and then to attend a meeting in person. There has never been, to our knowledge, a concern expressed regarding the process in which current consultations are carried out in person, and therefore any change that reduces that in-person contact and replaces it with online is something that may mean that fewer teachers or parents or local community members are able to engage with it. So we've suggested in our submission that hybrid meetings may be possible, that the benefits of fewer people attending a meeting by some of them going online may help the public health or address the public health risks of holding meetings in person. But for consultations regarding changes to schools, I think we are very clear that we want the maximum number of people being able to engage with the process, and that would suggest that that they can do so in the maximum number of ways, digital and in person.
Okay, I think I would strongly agree with that. I can put a similar question to a representative from COSLA, if that's okay, convener. I suppose my experience of this process is that local authorities, I know my own local authority in Dundee, you know, recent consultation in the last couple of years prior to the pandemic, actually, to close, merge two secondary schools, didn't get the answer they want, so ran it again in order to get the one that they wanted. I mean, I suppose my concern around this is around precedent. And if we put this through this, you know, there's a kind of a seeping situation where we could end up with no physical meetings, and we put through the emergency legislation, it's a reasonable thing to do. Does COSLA still believe that we should be having the kind of either physical meetings, that kind of level maximising engagement that the EIS are expressing as well?
So I think in the broadest sense, I think that we have for some time, I think, raised with the government the fact that we think that some of the aspects of the 2010 Act are quite burdensome. And in fact, I think if you look at the process, perhaps not in the exact example you make, but a case where a school has been mothballed and there's been the consultation that goes on then around that, that's been the case for some years. And then there's another consultation that goes on around closure that we feel that actually that is quite a burdensome process and quite a challenging one, and that one that takes a lot of resource. So I think that's something that generally we feel around the 2010 Act. I think where this comes from, and again, I think the point that we've been really clear on here is this is only around the use of public meetings during a pandemic, is the fact that during some of the last year, there were big periods of times where across big parts of the country, it was impossible to have people together inside at all. And because the flexibility was not given to councils, they were required to either sort of pause their processes, which meant when they were doing planning, perhaps around opening up new nurseries or the 1140 hours expansion, around thinking around the future of the school estate, some of those processes were put on pause, and it meant we weren't able to go and have the conversations that we needed to have and make sure that everyone was understanding about some of the steps we needed to take to improve services for communities, etc. So I think that's the crucial thing here, is we're talking about in a situation where there's a public health crisis where everywhere else there's being a limits on the number of people who can meet indoors. I think more broadly, if there is a conversation around when it is safe to do so, absolutely, that we would still support public meetings.
So, and I suppose the would you think it would be useful within this legislation to signal that we should have the maximum participation possible? That there should be a duty on local authorities to maximise participation in these forms of consultation. Would that be a reasonable position?
I don't think that would be unreasonable, but I think it should be within the I think sort of best endeavours, I think, would be the words that we take, because I think local authorities would, and as throughout the pandemic across a number of areas, there has been best endeavour attempts to make sure that we did make these accessible as possible. Not just in school consultations, but more broadly. However, there have been real challenges that put some of the stuff around the digital divide, which I think have been raised by others in the panel, we'd agree with, and think that it's a really important work for us all collectively to make sure that we're preparing for the future and the sort of how we upskill and ensure devices are available to all.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kevin.
Fergus Ewing.
Thank you. The COVID pandemic took us and everybody else by surprise. And if there is a future pandemic, that will be the case as well. I recognise and want to thank all the institutions represented today and local government for the work they did during the pandemic, and I value that. And the partnership approach is one that the Scottish Government, I'm perfectly sure, will always continue to take as a central way of operating. I don't think anyone would dispute that. But there does seem, convener, to be a kind of elephant in the room in this discussion, whose presence has been so far ignored. And that is that in a pandemic, there is a need for speed. And although Mr. Edward is quite correct, I think, in saying that it would be desirable if we could pass this legislation after Lady Poole's inquiry findings are known. As far as I know, there's no time limit in that, and it may well be a long time before that we reach that stage. Convener, it seems to me that all of us as Democrats want consultation, participation, but we must also recognise that in a pandemic there is a need for speed, and delay of even a few days can be critical. And therefore, could I put it to particularly Mr. Sim and Mr. Little that even if there is a substance to some of their arguments, and I'd be interested to see what the Cabinet Secretary says about some of the arguments about the detail, the granular detail, and hear why these powers are necessary. But nonetheless, in principle, if government cannot act quickly, as they can in England, where they already have these powers and they've had them for 10 years, then surely that must carry with it a very serious risk to public health, and that is not something that any of us should be willing to thole, permit or accept.
Alistair Sim.
I could maybe just refer back to what I said to Mr. Dornan, which was, you know, what we're actually trying to do here is make sure that if there has to be emergency legislation, this emergency legislation is crafted well so that it can be used well at speed in the event of another unforeseen severe public health emergency. And I think it will be used better at speed if ministers are able to say in general terms what should be done. For instance, to say that there should be severe restrictions on in-person learning because of the emergency, and let institutions get on with the granular implementation of an overall direction so that they can decide course by course, student by student, you know, who are the people who absolutely need to be there within the overall strictures imposed by ministers.
But respect,
so because ministers
Sim,
can't do that.
With respect, I mean, how long is this going to take? I mean, I'm advised, it's not a world with which I'm familiar, that the decision-making process in universities can be done swiftly.
Yes.
But matters of a week, we have seen very serious criticism of both governments, Scotland and the Westminster government, that they've acted too slowly. Now, whether these criticisms are founded or not, time will tell, the inquiry will look into this. But I think many people suspect that if decisions were taken, there were the right decisions, but not taken quickly enough. Aren't you proposing an inbuilt system which will inevitably lead to delay because you add to the Scottish Government process, which would involve making the decisions, but in close consultation with your members and universities. But to add to that, you then overlay a college or university consultation process. You could lose, even if you do it in a week, surely that's too late, and that is the whole point.
I think actually what we're proposing would be quicker, because ministers wouldn't have to sort of come up with a list of saying, oh, you know, are the podiatrists in our list or not, or have we thought about every possible health discipline that should be prioritised for continuing education. I think if they say, here's our broad priorities, I mean, university, the experience of the pandemic is universities, you know, within a day, 2 days, you know, extremely quickly, will decide what needs to be closed, what needs to be opened,
well, you know,
within that general
structure.
So I think we're actually trying to create something quicker here.
Yes, well, with respect, sir, what would happen if there's a disagreement? I mean, my point is that in a pandemic, there has to be emergency action. And at the end of the day, if the government don't have power to do something, then, as Mr. Greer has pointed out, you could end up in the courts. And by that time, it's all too late. thousands of other people have got the virus. So I don't really think, with respect, that the argument you're making is well-intentioned, and no doubt discussions can be had about the granular detail in any event, because in my experience in government, officials were constantly working closely with those affected, as I think you've indicated yourself. But surely you must accept, as a point of principle, the buck stops with the government. If they don't have the powers, they could end up in a situation where they cannot take the action necessary on the basis of the public health evidence to protect public health in Scotland.
I think the government, as we've described in our paper, we see a case for the government having emergency powers. We think those will be used more swiftly and more effectively if government says an over level, here is the emergency action that is required, and then lets the institutions, and indeed holds the institutions accountable for getting on with it.
Let's also bring in Paul Little, Fergus. Let's have Paul Little, yeah. And then we'll hear from John Edward.
I think Fergus was talking about a future pandemic. What I want to reinforce is that there's a present crisis today. We are not talking about lost learning enough. We are not talking about the swinging cuts that are facing colleges. And I can't wait for them to come. I have to plan for them now, should they come. So potentially I have to plan to reduce 1,300 learning places, to cut 70 courses. I have to plan to help well over 1,000 learners catch up in their learning. I have to plan for mental health responses. I have to deal with the attempted suicide I had last weekend. I have to deal with the self-harm that happened yesterday. Those are very real issues. At the same time as that, I have to help the upskilling and reskilling of the city centres. I've got a number of distressed economic sectors in retail and in construction and, for example, in hospitality. Those need to be upskilled and reskilled. During the pandemic, we were able to help 10,000 employees, but there is even more coming. I have to help the mothers who are new to Glasgow and wish to learn English as a second other language. I'm presently only able to help 1,700. There are 10,000 on the waiting list.
Convener, I don't want to interrupt. Convener, I'm aware of from previous work with Paul Little of the good work that he does in his college, and I applaud him for that, and I do value that. But, you know, with respect, sir, this is not what we're here to talk about today. It's very, very important, but it's not the question I asked. And behind you, to your left, there is a plaque, which I assume is yours, just behind you to your left, which has got the Latin motto, Semper Paratus, which, as I understand, means always ready. My point is that governments must be always ready, and unless they have the emergency powers, they cannot act swiftly. That is the point. We are not going to be semper paratus. We will be unprepared without the necessary powers that may be necessary, because in a future pandemic, convener, the problems we have may be slightly different or entirely different from the problems that we faced in the COVID pandemic. History doesn't repeat itself precisely in many respects. So surely we do need to be ready, Paul, for the future. And that's what I asked. It wasn't about the other problems that you face. And I'm not in any way a denigrating your raising them, but they're not actually relevant to today. And with respect, I do think that both yourself and Mr. Sim have protested too much today and not accepted the absolute fundamental principle that governments, and this is the case with the UK government,
Fergus,
convener, I think,
you,
presumably
Fergus,
support that, have to be able to act swiftly.
Fergus, can I ask you to ask a question so we can move on? Or
well,
we go
does,
back
does
to...
Professor Little not accept that governments must have powers to act swiftly, and it's not possible to know in advance precisely what action must be taken?
All
and
right.
At the end of the day, it must be the government that have these powers. Otherwise, we're not able to protect public health.
Paul,
if I could briefly answer you, I will trade you carpe diem for semper paratus. Seize the day. The challenge is our experience of previous government legislation as pertaining to the college sector is it has been burdensome. It is actually better colleges' ability to respond in an educational way, and this legislation might actually feather that response in an emergency way. That's based on our experience. We are dealing with experience and learning from it, and if there's further legislation that will feather colleges, then actually that is going to substantially undermine institutional autonomy and the institutional response at an economic and a social and an educational way. That's based on experience of right here, right now, and since the last piece of legislation was enacted to college. And I appreciate your kind comments about what we've achieved so far. Thank you.
John Edward.
I wanted to come back on a couple of things. The first was on speed. I was in a meeting of the SQA contingency group, which hadn't met for over 10 years in Victoria Quay, one day, and examinations were cancelled within 48 hours and schools were closed that week. Speed is not a problem. And indeed, we were in some cases ahead of England, which, as has been pointed out, had different legislation. In some cases, we were behind. England had as many problems as the rest of us in terms of getting the story correct. So I don't think that there's necessarily any comparison to draw there. The other thing I would say is, and I go back to our autonomy, you know, the proposals here present a financial risk as well as a governance risk to our institutions. And I'm not naive enough to expect that if I came begging for a huge amount of financial support that our sector would be front of the queue in any part of Scotland. And I don't expect it would be. That's fine. But what I will say is that the idea that any of our institutions, any of our staff or any of our governing boards would not put public health absolutely at the top of whatever they would do in any situation is frankly laughable. Protecting public health, protecting the well-being, the health, the advancement and the development of the people in our care is our number one, our sole priority. So the idea that it requires legislation for us to do what is right by them, I think is wide of the mark.
Michael Mara.
Just briefly, Convener. I mean, the idea that Fergus Ewan is expounding that this pandemic was not predicted, I think, is completely wrong. Pandemics were predicted globally by many experts. They're high on risk registers internationally. We had pandemic planning activity in Scotland that was ignored by the Scottish Government. So when the review that's been undertaken comes through, we'll get a better idea of this. I wanted to, John Edward mentioned comparison with England there. Are members on the panel aware of any other international comparisons that we might look at where actually the response was better? Because I'm fairly critical of the response in England, Wales and in Scotland in terms of the government. So is there a legislative framework for emergency response internationally with partners that you're aware of that we should be looking at, both as a committee and a parliament, that's a better framework so that we can get the response correct next time?
I'll be honest, I don't know. I think everyone has been operating in different legislative contexts. It really interesting to know our nose has probably been a bit too close to the grindstone over the past 2 years to have that look.
Yeah, and I think that's my point, Convener, that actually it would be better that we're looking at this legislation in a broader sense where we can understand the impact of the pandemic, we do this properly, you know, and we don't legislate at haste and repent at leisure.
And as we conclude the session, I'm going to turn to our panellists and just ask them if there's anything that they would like to add to the evidence they've given us this morning. Maybe the conversation hasn't gone in that direction, but it's something you feel you need to get onto our record because you're informing us in a very important way about how we proceed with this legislation. Alistair, sir.
Could I just actually just respond to a point that I meant to respond to earlier that David Belsey made, which is, you know, the partnership with, you know, students and staff, with the trade unions and with the student associations has been incredibly important. And just to pick up on a point David Belsey made, actually our proposal does specifically say that consultation with student and staff representatives would continue to be a really important part of any structure of addressing a further emergency.
And was there anything further you wanted to add, Alistair Sim?
No, that's it. Thank you.
Paul Little.
To reinforce the fact that colleges were not only part of the saving lives, but we were very much part of the saving livelihoods, and that's ongoing. And we will be very much part, probably for the next decade, of the saving life chances involved in that. Very often we've spent a lot of time today talking about urgency situations, but we are going to have to live with the after effects of this pandemic. We all know that the poor and those who have gone into this pandemic weaker are probably going to come out of it weaker, and colleges are very much at that sharp end. And the challenges that we face in supporting, you know, social cohesion are great, but as are the challenges of supporting economic renewal. And just finally, I'd like to maybe suggest that I'd be happy to contribute to your discussion on regionalisation when this committee looks at it, because some of the effects that we spoke about today are probably very pertinent to there. But thank you.
We would welcome that very much. Matthew Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. It was a point I touched on, but just to expand briefly around the fact that I think while we're supportive of the continued direction powers, we're very, very keen that there is a mechanism put in place, which means that the views of local government are taken on board when those are crafted, because there are, you know, wide-ranging powers as they stand just now, and we would need assurances to make sure that those were deliverable and that we could meet them within the resources that we have. I think one of the other things we're keen to point out around the partnership has worked well in terms of the COVID-19 Education Recovery Group, which we've co-chaired with the Scottish Government. And in fact, we're disappointed that that hasn't been expanded into other areas. I think perhaps also the Scottish Education Council, which these issues in the round, we'd be keen that that was there. And more broadly, I think consultation around the National Care Service and particularly the possible inclusion of children's services within that is an area we continue to welcome further engagement around.
Diane Stockton.
Thanks. I was just going to point out that SAGE published some papers on the 1st of March, sorry, the 1st of February, looking at the likelihood of future variants, and that paper suggests that the Omicron was unusually mild and that future ones are likely to be closer to variants such as the Delta that we've had before. So we do need to, however that's best achieved, we do need to be able to respond quickly if a more severe variant does come along in the near future. The partnership working has worked brilliantly from our point of view, from public health point of view. How that quick response is done is not a matter for myself, but just to make that point that we need to be able to respond quickly. And that's across the whole spectrum of stepping up surveillance, testing capacity, genomic sequencing, vaccine effectiveness work, mitigations as required, guidance. So it's just having that capability there in whatever way is best to achieve that. Thank you.
David Belsey, do you want to add anything?
Yes, if I may. I think, again, we'd like to say that partnership working has worked. We've been on the school SIR group and the advanced learning SIR group, and I think that the partnership working has led to an improved response and clearly is in the best interest of all stakeholders. I would urge the committee to look at the EIS's proposals around giving local authorities, working with their public health professionals and committees and directors, the ability to close schools on public health grounds should the local conditions warrant it in their view. And lastly, I'd like to make the point, staff representatives are not trade union representatives. A staff representative can be anybody a university chooses, but trade union representatives are elected democratically by their trade union branches. And that's what I think is the point I was trying to make earlier with regards to University of Scotland's submission.
Thank you. And John Edward.
Just a couple of things. We haven't talked about another aspect of the bill, which is vaccines and immunisations. And I would stress the committee to look at the huge raft of vaccinations and immunisations that are asked of school-age pupils now. And if we're looking to future pandemics and the likelihood of future vaccines, and now we're vaccinating primary school kids, that trying to put some order to that huge programme that's in place now, that's added in year on year, HPV for boys, whatever, be one thing. On the stuff we've been discussing this morning, I stress the point again, for us, this is not just financial risk, but it's existential risk if schools are asked to close. And therefore, they will jealously protect their ability to serve the pupils that are in those schools. Our working with the government and with Public Health Scotland, the NHS, has been exemplary throughout this period. There is no criticism whatsoever in us in how this has gone, and that's why we wouldn't necessarily seek to change it. And I do make the point that we represent international pupils, day and boarding, from 50, 60 mm-hmm. different countries, and all of them have a slightly different... We have a different obligation to them in terms of their ability to travel, their ability to liaise with each other, their well-being. And just to stress that point, this is the first week in 2 years that we've been worrying more about their emotional well-being of our Ukrainian and Russian students than we have about the other borders. So it's a big, big issue. And all of this stuff, though it seems esoteric at one level, does affect very, very directly the lives of young people.
Thank you, and thanks to all of you. Thanks to Paul Little, Matthew Sweeney, David Belsey, Diane Stockton, John Edward, and Alistair Sim for joining us this morning. Your evidence has been very valuable to us. It will inform our next session, which will be with the Cabinet Secretary herself. So at this point, I'd like to thank you for your time, and we will have a brief suspension of a few minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you, and a good morning to you. We'll welcome back. We will now hear from our second panel of witnesses as we continue to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1. So can I welcome Megan Farr, Policy Officer, Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland, and Liam Fowley, Vice Chair of the Board of the Scottish Youth Parliament. You're both very welcome. Unfortunately, we are a bit short of time today, so we will be asking you to give us some quick answers. We'll have lots of questions, and if you can keep your answers brief, that would be fantastic. And any outstanding matters that need to be followed up, we will ask for that to be done in writing. So I'd like to first turn to Megan. Megan, in your written evidence to us, you say, and if I may quote, states' abilities to interfere with human rights in a time of emergency are not unlimited. Any emergency powers must be lawful, necessary, proportionate and time-limited. We therefore have considerable concerns about the proposals in this legislation which would place what were time-limited emergency measures permanently into statute for use by any future government without prior reference to Parliament. Would you like to expand on what you gave us in writing?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I think that's one of the major tests in international human rights law. As our response says, both the European Convention on Human Rights, Article 15, and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, Article 4, allow that human rights are interfered with when there is an emergency, but it does place quite a high test on that happening. We acknowledge that the government have put in the tests of proportionality and necessity into their proposals, but we're still concerned that that's left up to Scottish ministers. I think that the parliamentary scrutiny that both this Parliament and Westminster were able to put in place when the emergency legislation was passed that enabled organisations such as ourselves, members of civil societies and others to provide evidence and to provide some challenge. That level of scrutiny was very important at the beginning of the pandemic. This Parliament particularly did quite well in pivoting to working online, for example, and in virtual sittings. And we're all much better at that than we were 2 years ago. So I feel that's really important. I think it's important as well in giving a sense of public legitimacy in any future pandemic. The other thing is that at the moment, this bill is largely putting in place what might have been useful to have in place at the beginning of the current pandemic. The next one may be different, and the next emergency that Scotland faces may not be a pandemic, it may be something else. And there's a risk, I think, of putting a lot of work into putting in place arrangements for the last emergency rather than planning in advance for the next one. Your previous panel, there was mention of the planning that is done in local authorities around civil contingencies, that certainly can be drawn on, and there was a lot of planning done around future pandemics for that. And from the Scottish Government point of view, it's absolutely legitimate for them to have this planning and to have draft legislation being reviewed and updated on a regular basis, ready to go, so to speak. But our concern is that without the level of parliamentary scrutiny that the emergency legislation received last time round, there's a real risk that a future government, not necessarily the current incumbents, but any future government who would have these powers, because they're not time limited, could bring in force quite significant interferences with human rights, and particularly with children's human rights in respect of issues around youth justice and around education, without that level of scrutiny to ensure that they are proportionate, necessary, time limited, and lawful.
Can I ask you a second question, and this may lead you to repeat some things you've already said, but I think it's useful to get this on the record. In your evidence, you call into question the lawfulness of this bill under the terms of Article 15 of the ACHR. Why do you say that?
It's because it anticipates powers going into place permanently that are potentially emergency powers. I can't say whether or not that would be up to the European Court to decide whether it was legitimate in terms of Article 15, but it may be unlawful in terms of that. And some of the proposals in the current bill may also breach other rights. And in particular, there are a couple of issues that link into Article 8 rights in terms of private and family life. The two specific examples are around directing individuals to attend specified education establishments. Parents have a right to, have a duty to educate their children, but they also have a right to choose how that happens. There's a risk there that could be open to challenge. And the other one actually is around probably what's a relatively obscure one, and that's about childminders who usually work in their own homes, and those are usually homes that also contain children, and giving the government the power to legislate what happens in the homes of individual children, families which include children. So that's just a couple of the examples. But I think the main thing to come back to is that that's why the parliamentary scrutiny at the time that emergency legislation is brought into force is important. Now, I'm aware that the Scottish Government have proposed that regulations should be laid under the affirmative procedure, but if you look at our evidence to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee on made affirmative, the effect of the made affirmative procedure, as it's been used over the last 2 years, is that measures are brought into force often very late, often without advance sight of them, and they're often published at the point of coming into force. And so those interferences have already happened before that opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny. Our comments are not a criticism of the current government. It is one of the things with human rights law is that we need to legislate on the basis of any government using these powers. And political situations in countries can change. And I think that it's a risk having legislation sitting on the books that could be used at some future date by some future government inappropriately when it interferes to the extent this does with human rights.
So you basically hold out the prospect that this law, should it become law, would be open to challenge in the courts?
I think there is the possibility that that it could be either now or at a future date. The other issue around lawfulness is I only caught some of the discussion last time as I was waiting outside, but it was also the talk about taking people to court. I mean, if, as happened in the recent pandemic, organisations failed to voluntarily, for example, close schools, it wouldn't be any different from a situation if they ignored legislation that told them to close schools. Both would result in having to take that establishment to court.
Liam,
it would be on a different basis.
Yeah. Liam, what are your concerns on the issue of human rights that are raised by the Commission?
Technicalities of it are quite vast of the bill in general, I should caveat all that I'll say that we've had very minimal opportunity to engage with young people as we'd like on the bill, because this sort of thing would take longer to do due to the technicalities, but those we have consulted have a broad range of concerns and a broad range of agreement as well. There's no one clear thought process from young people regards the bill or indeed the kind of human rights aspect of it as well. I think the big thing that concerns young people and what come through quite clear in the consultation that we did do is that on the grounds of public health, yes, these decisions will have to be made, but there also has to be provisions made for the alternative. So if we look back to March 2020, digital exclusion was rife, the provision for young people with additional support needs was practically non-existent in their experiences, and due to that, young people are almost scarred by it because they think, well, if they're going to shut schools again, they've got to have something better in place. It did improve over time, and the whole young people should have, or the bill should have a provision for young people to be given a proper quality education. Isn't going to be properly impacted if the schools close themselves.
How do you, what do you specifically propose in that area then?
I wouldn't want to specifically propose anything because I've not consulted with young people on it, and I take great pride in saying that we do that, but I think there should be provision in the bill that, for example, young people have access to high-quality online learning, which wasn't in place in March 2020.
Right, you're shaking your head very vigorously, Megan.
Nodding.
Yes, sorry, you're nodding vigorously, not shaking, nodding, yes.
Yeah, I just want to echo what Liam says about the importance of involving children and young people. And I mentioned earlier about government's planning for future emergencies, not just pandemic or anything. And that's something that can happen and must happen with the involvement of children and young people when it comes to education provision. That's when the opportunity is there before we're putting it in place. But then that must be that has happened as part of the process that Parliament play as human rights guarantors in scrutinising legislation, is to look at, did Scottish Government, when it was putting this planning process in place, when they were considering their draft legislation that they have sitting, hopefully ready to go in another pandemic, did they consult with children and young people? Did children and young people participate in that decision-making in a way that ensures that we don't repeat some of the issues that came up during the course of the last 2 years, where children and young people's views and indeed their needs and their rights were often overlooked?
So in connection, in specific terms, can you talk a little about your concerns around school closures?
It may be necessary to close schools again for public health measures, or hypothetically for another reason. That's not something we would oppose absolutely, but it needs to be acknowledged, and we've got a much bigger understanding now, I think, than we did 2 years ago as a society, the impact that closing schools has on the children and young people, on their families, and actually on wider society. It has really profound workforce implications for places like social care and health. And that's why we think that a decision of that magnitude does need parliamentary scrutiny at the time, to make sure that all of those impacts on children and young people have been considered when that decision is made. Now, it may need to be done on public health grounds and very quickly, and that's why having the preparation ready. In terms of individual schools closing on public health grounds, my understanding is that can happen, usually on the recommendation of the Director of Public Health. Is my understanding of how that usually happens. My understanding is that power is in place to do that, but I'm not an expert in how education authorities individually run. It may be that different local authorities have different practice in place around closure of schools. So the closure of individual schools, I think, is something that happens occasionally and probably a handful of schools a year for different public health measures in non-pandemic times. Closing schools wholesale, though, every school in the country closing, it is a really, really, really significant interference with children's human rights, and it needs to be treated with the gravity that reflects that.
And your conclusion is that the Scottish Minister should not have the power to do that unilaterally, then?
I think that they should bring emergency legislation to Parliament to achieve that. Parliament has... both the members of this Parliament but also the staff of this Parliament have really shown amazing innovation and resilience in the last 2 years, and I think Parliament are up to that job. And I think that the only justifiable exception would be if Parliament were unable to consider emergency legislation in a timely manner.
So there's something on the shelf that's pulled down and dusted off and utilised in the situation if it meets the need.
And that's a fairly... basic part of emergency planning, as it happens, is that governments and local authorities and businesses and even the Office of the Children's Commissioner have plans ready for if something major happens that interferes with how they operate. And with government, it's at the level of, do we have to close all the schools?
But going forward, your position is that we should revert to the powers that existed before the pandemic?
That's not my decision to make. Our position is that it is around the importance of parliamentary scrutiny when bringing powers into force. How Parliament legislates to achieve that is a matter for yourselves and obviously government in terms of how they draft their bills.
Ross Greer.
Just on that last point, Megan, around the potential for government to bring forward emergency legislation if existing legislation isn't sufficient, Does that not take us back to, it was part of the discussion we just had with the last panel actually around the importance of parliamentary scrutiny, but wider public scrutiny of legislation. I think we all accept that, I think those of us who were there at the time were quite proud of the process that we undertook with last year's two bills. Emergency legislation vastly limits the opportunity for both parliamentary and public scrutiny. Indeed, both of your organisations had very limited opportunity to contribute to those pieces of legislation. Is this not a better process, doing this now through the use of legislation that isn't emergency, isn't time limited, where we can thoroughly scrutinise both as parliamentarians, but organisations like yourselves can thoroughly scrutinise and amend if necessary that legislation? Is this not a preferable approach to an emergency one?
I think there's two middle grounds, and one is, as I've discussed, having legislation ready to go. The other way would be to amend this bill in a way that that ensured that that test of being proportionate and necessary was definitely going to be put in place before a measure came into force. Theorising here, potentially there is a workaround where there was parliamentary scrutiny of it coming into of particular bits being brought into force in an emergency situation, but the fix to that ability for public involvement, particularly and children and young people's involvement, is that planning is much more transparent, is not sort of done in a corner without knowing. People know there's emergency happens. We have more knowledge of that, experience of that in society than we've ever had in most of our lives, in fact, probably all of our lifetimes. You know, nothing like this has happened since the Second World War in terms of the interferences in individuals' human rights. And if that planning is done in a transparent way, that those opportunities to be part of that discussion can happen before the legislation is brought to Parliament, and then Parliament, as human rights guarantors, can ask the questions of, did this happen? Can ask to see the children's rights impact assessments, the equality impact assessments, the human rights impact assessments. Did this actually happen? That will help you do your job if Scottish Government have done that work in advance. We're not convinced that it's impossible to bring this in as emergency legislation, and it also allows it to be fine-tuned to take account of the specific circumstances of the next emergency.
Thanks. And just very briefly, one of the other points you made quite rightly is obviously when legislating in areas like human rights on a permanent basis, we need to think not just of who the current government is, the current composition of Parliament, mm-hmm. but that anyone could be in power in the future. But does that not equally apply to the other organisations we're talking about? We just discussed in the last panel, there was very good partnership working mm-hmm. with universities, with colleges, with student accommodation providers, etc. last time around. We can't guarantee that next time around. What we can guarantee, though, is that governments will always be held accountable by Parliament and ultimately by the public, whereas it's much harder to hold a private provider student accommodation to account, mm-hmm. particularly in an emergency situation. Mm-hmm. So if it's about a balance of where that power lies, even when we don't know who the individuals are going to be and what their motivations might be, is it not better having that power with a democratically accountable government rather than a private accommodation mm-hmm. provider?
I think, first of all, that the student accommodation is another one which isn't always recognised as being someone's home. Mm-hmm. And if you're a student, particularly if you're a student who is at student is in student accommodation year round, that is for some children their permanent home. For older students, for young people who are care experienced, that's their permanent home. So first of all, what you're suggesting is legislation that interferes with people's lives in their home, and that needs to be considered with quite a lot of care and in the context in which it's being brought into force. But I think if they're going to cooperate or not actually doesn't depend on whether the legislation is passed on an emergency ground as a situation evolves, or if it's been passed in 2022 and has sat on the books for 10 or more years. We don't know when this is next going to be needed. I'm inclined to think that legislation that has been brought through in the context of a specific evolving emergency is probably more likely to meet the needs of children and young people.
Thank you.
Alderman Dale.
Thank you, Convener. Just for absolute clarity, you feel it's the lack of proportionality that could make this legislation unlawful?
No, I feel that it is the lack of a test for proportionality and necessity and the issue around time limited, because these powers aren't time limited. They can be brought in but the legislation on the book is on the book permanently. So it's not that the bill itself isn't proportionate, it's that the ability to bring in the powers on the judgment of Scottish ministers doesn't have democratic scrutiny of the decision of whether it is necessary and proportionate, and the potential that made affirmative procedure is used means they can be brought into power with that parliamentary scrutiny happening retrospectively.
And do you think that there's a difference? I mean, there's a sort of sliding scale, because obviously passing new emergency legislation requires the kind of full parliamentary process. If you just had to bring it into force provision, does that not create a lower bar? I just wonder, whether there would be a question, whether that is proportionate for the scale of measures that this enables. I mean, we're talking about pretty fundamental rights being removed in terms of education. Is bring it into force enough?
It's legitimate in terms of ECHR Article 15 to have these rights and use them in an emergency context, as we did.
But you think I bring it into force provision would meet that? You think that would meet that test?
That would be a decision for it were to be challenged in the court for the court. As far as I know, there's relatively limited case law on it. And I'm not an expert in ECHR case law. I can ask a colleague who is and get back to you on that.
Because I'd just be interested, because obviously there's a different type of consultation, a different type of, effectively it's a different type of consent. Yeah. You're relying upon as a member of parliament, in bringing something into force, than you are in putting the legislation onto the statute book and having it sit there. Yeah. So I'd just be interested in that and anything more you could provide. But not to push you if you don't feel comfortable. Yeah. But as in, anything from a colleague would be helpful.
Yeah, I think the test is it proportionate and legitimate and necessary. And importantly, time limited, and with the current emergency legislation, it has been brought back to Parliament for review on a regular basis. So that would be the conditions that whatever was put in place, whether that be a bill that was brought into force or a new piece of legislation which government had had. What we're effectively talking about is having something on the books or in a drawer.
One has a lower hurdle to pass. I mean, I think that would be the point I would make. One has a lower...
No, they must... Both bringing into force existing legislation and creating new legislation from a human rights point of view needs to pass those four tests. Necessary, proportionate, time limit.
As a lower parliamentary hurdle. One has a lower parliamentary hurdle in terms of the scrutiny and the kind of process it has to follow.
That would be their decision for Parliament and how it approached the two things. But in terms of made affirmative... we've made our views known in the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee around some of the issues that arose with the use of made affirmative and very later a bit, and retrospective scrutiny of that.
And the case for using that process, in your view, would diminish over time and would be less proportionate if you're planning in advance for an emergency. I think that's a fair comment.
I am very aware that pandemics and other emergencies can change course very quickly. We saw that with Omicron, so I wouldn't like to give a categorical answer about the use of that procedure in specific instances. And I think we said that in our response, albeit that I think it predated Omicron, and that things can move quickly and it may be necessary. But it is a weakness of that measure that there isn't the same amount of scrutiny, and that would be our concern about this bill being brought into force, the measures in this bill being brought into force on that basis.
Thanks.
I'm very aware that Liam isn't getting a chance to speak.
Liam, do you want to add anything?
No, it's just very technical, and I'm not an expert in the kind of technical aspect of it. What I can tell you very concretely is that young people... Both processes that were outlined there, young people regularly feel like they're an afterthought in both of those processes. If we go back to March, scary time, but what came through very clear at that point is young people felt like they were being ignored. They didn't have the opportunity to get their voices heard. I sit on the COVID Education Recovery Group and the Scottish Education Council, not representing them today, but we were invited onto those groups after, one, a lot of advocacy, and two, quite later on. It happened later on in 2020. And that was fantastic that we were getting a seat at that table. And it's really important that we're getting young people around that that sort of table and getting engaged in that sort of way. But at that time, when things were happening very rapidly, and young people agree they had to happen very rapidly, they still felt like they were just shift to the side. And it's very difficult reality, unfortunately, that young people come through with it. In terms of the actual legislation itself, limited consultation with young people, as I've said, there was overwhelming kind of majority agreed that the government should have these powers, especially on the public health basis. But there are some who are more sceptical about that level of power and the kind of how it, what is classed as the extreme circumstance and how clear that is. There were a couple of young people that came through, and it's only fair to represent them and say that the balance was off in terms of risk and freedom. I'll give you a quote from one. The way it's run, they are killing people. COVID's killing people. Mental health is killing people. I know it's very blunt and it's very harsh, but it's true. And I think that rings true, that the mental health aspect of a school closure is absolutely immeasurable. The impact it's had has been vast, and you'll regularly hear young people say that there is a concurrent pandemic here, and that is the mental health pandemic.
Well, that is well said. Willie Rennie.
I think Megan... Liam, if you forgive me, I think Megan, you've provided a very pragmatic response to it, and I think you've set out potentially a way ahead with dealing with this that deals with the concerns that some of my colleagues, including Fergus Ewan, expressed earlier on about need to respond quickly in an emergency, whilst making sure that we don't have permanent emergency powers that are disproportionate. We had... I suppose there's two elements to this then. There is the length of time that the powers are in place, and then there's the content. And we heard from an earlier session about effectively leaders of various higher education institutions think that this is micromanaging far too much, and that there should be broad principles and they should be allowed to get on with implementing. So there's a debate about that, about whether that's right or not. And then there's the debate about the length of time. What I think, I would quite like you to comment on the content aspect, if that's okay, but also, are you really just saying that we should use the time now to debate the content and then have the legislation ready to roll if the events were to happen again? Is that what you're really saying? So perhaps rather than legislating now, we should debate now and get it ready. Is that what you're recommending as a process?
It's not for me to dictate what you do or what Scottish Government do. I think that that for some of the content in this, there probably is too much detail, and there is that risk that it's responding to the last emergency, not the next emergency. And that's something that is often a pitfall of emergency planning. And could put us in the position we were in last year, two years ago, of perhaps not being as prepared as we should have been for this to happen. And certainly we've been talking about a pandemic of the extent of this one. Emergency planning circles were definitely talking about that sort of thing before the H1N1 pandemic, which is now 13, 14 years ago. So there's a risk that if we concentrate too hard on the last emergency, we don't take into account what other things could happen. And we're very lucky in Scotland. We're a country that doesn't have volcanoes and earthquakes and tornadoes and other big emergencies. But there are other things that could happen that could have a really serious impact on society. My mind is currently blank as to examples. But I think it needs to be carefully thought about how is the best thing to do at this point in the pandemic, and there potentially is a place for emergency powers to continue, but whether this is the point at which to be setting down in legislation that will be available for use unless repealed to any future government of any political flavour, of any attitude in possibly after all of us have long retired, except perhaps Liam. Sorry, shouldn't single out the young person. But, you know, really long-lasting and potentially significant legislation on human rights terms at this point, or whether we're actually still in a stage where we should be reviewing what's happened and how things could have been done better, because I think we're still not in a point where children and young people are being listened to enough, and we're still not in a point where all of the rights issues that arose during the pandemic for children and young people actually were addressed. You'll have heard, and this was not planned, I did not know when I wrote my submission evidence to you that this was happening today, but that the Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Prisons today has issued a call around the 16 and 17-year-olds who are in prison in Scotland. An average of 18 children have been in prison in Scotland during the course of this academic. It's 18 children each week on average. There are currently 14, of whom 10 haven't been tried. Three have been convicted and sentenced, and one is waiting sentencing. That number has moved from being 41% in the first 3 months of the pandemic are untried, to 78% in the last 3 months of the pandemic are untried. Some of those children during points in the pandemic, and not just in the early stages, also where there's been outbreaks and also as a reaction to Omicron, have been confined to their cells for up to 23 hours a day, having received no education, no time for recreation, no time for support and counselling. These are not children, and the Commissioner was on the radio this morning saying, these are not children who've committed serious crimes in many cases. We've heard of one instance of a child who was sent to Polmont for failing to appear as a witness in a court case recently. We wrote to the Cabinet Secretary about that just a couple of weeks ago, and there's a link to that in our, or details of that in our evidence. We've also heard of potential trafficking victims being remanded to Polmont, despite the fact that we have a non-prosecution presumption around victims of trafficking, let alone child victims of trafficking in Scotland. This bill also addresses the early release measures. Not a single child has benefited from the early release measures in the last 2 years since those have been in place, to our knowledge. None of the children who are on remand, and that at the moment is roughly 80%, can. So we would, one of the things we would like to see this bill do that would actually be a progressive human rights response to the pandemic for children and young people is to alter that legislation or update that legislation to ensure that children who are in prison but are untried can be moved to settings which are more appropriate, that may be secure in some cases and secure care, but secure care, they have been able to continue with education. That's those children's homes, so they weren't subject to the same restrictions. So children secure care were able to continue to receive education, support, the kind of therapy they need to rehabilitate themselves, and they are supported to rehabilitate themselves, and that's how we should be approaching children who are in conflict with the law. Aware I've gone a little bit off topic, but I think this is, and as I say, it's merely serendipity that the inspector's views have come out today, but I think that's actually a really important issue that was overlooked. I think it got about a minute and a half's attention at Criminal Justice Committee last week, and that's one of the reasons I've jumped in. So apologies.
I'm really grateful as a Liberal that you've raised that issue. What has been the response from government to that proposal?
It's been mixed. I believe there was a letter in last night, which I haven't had a chance to look at. Unfortunately, I couldn't get into my system when I came into Parliament this morning. But they're talking mostly in long-term about long-term strategies, about getting 16 and 17-year-olds out of the adult justice services, so out of prisons, and that includes young and fed institutions. Polmont is a prison. It's not a secure care setting. It's not based on care and rehabilitation in the way that secure is. So they're mostly talking about long-term aims. In terms of this committee's remit, there's a big issue around 16 and 17-year-olds in the children's hearing system, which is a barrier to ensuring that children in conflict with the law are dealt with as children, because not all 16 and 17-year-olds can be referred to the children's hearing system, and that falls with, I noticed on the website, on your remit. They're talking about those long-term plans around reform of children's hearings and that, rather than addressing the short-term issue of these really vulnerable children, many of whom have not committed serious crimes, because actually serious crimes often get into secure. We've also heard instances where a child has ended up in Holman due to a lack of places in secure care being available. We think this needs a really urgent issue, because the reason the proportion of children who are untried in prison has increased is partly because of the delays in the court system. And that's why we've gone from, you know, the proportion has doubled. Whilst the numbers remain low, the proportion who are untried has doubled during the course of the pandemic.
Thank you. I think this merits quite a lot of further discussion, but I probably would try the committee's patience if we go too far down this route. But
thank you for indulging me.
No, I mean, perhaps the committee will look at whether we want to return to this issue at another time. Can I ask one final question to both of you? It was suggested earlier on that we should logically be waiting for the public inquiry to happen, consider, debate and conclude before we consider what further legislation is required for future emergency situations. Is that something that you would think is would be a wise thing to do? Perhaps we start off with Liam.
I mean, on the specifics of it, I won't give a definitive answer, but I think in both this and that inquiry, children and young people have been meaningfully participated regularly throughout it. One can make the argument that they should be front and centre of it. But I think in order to... ultimately, I think this bill has to have further engagement with children and young people so it can be made, because they were young people were hit hard during the pandemic. We all were, but of course young people were as well. The inquiry itself, whether it should conclude by the time this legislation comes into play, is very specific in this question. But I just think that in the inquiry, more further proper meaningful participation, not one person, one young person stuck in the room at the end of the table participation. They're two very different types. Sorry, I just realised that that's what's happening here. That's not what's, that's not what I'm referring to.
My hand's up.
but proper meaningful participation, both with the inquiry and this bill, does require to be taken forward.
Okay. Megan?
Absolutely agree with Liam in terms of the importance of meaningful, active participation and participation that actually changes things. If the participation of children and young people doesn't change what happens, you may as well not do it. And we've had examples of that during the course of the pandemic, where children and young people, or a child or young person, and often Liam or one of the other SYPs, has been at tables, and it is very difficult to see what impact they actually had. And that's why this model is a model, but it cannot be the only model. And in terms of things like a public inquiry that are judge-led, that are often based on a very formal approach to taking evidence, to gathering views, there is a real risk that we privilege people who are already privileged in society, and goes beyond children and young people, but children and young people are the ones I'm here to speak about. But there's been a lot of good work recently in terms of improving the quality of how inquiries are conducted in terms of including a wider range of people. But conversely, you often hear, and you often hear in the chamber in here, those views will be heard, or people talking about hearing views. Participation isn't about hearing views, it's about being part of decision making and making a difference. And hearing views is one thing, but if you say you're going to hear the views, that also leaves you open to being able to ignore views. It has to be really active participation that really looks at a broad range of children and young people's experiences.
Thank you. Okay, thanks.
I have to say that one of the most disturbing things I've read in any of the evidence that we've ever received as a committee is that sentence from the Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland, that says in Scotland that conditions for children in prison were in breach not only of UNCRC, but also the prohibition on torture, inhumane and degrading treatment or punishment in terms of Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights. Quite an extraordinary thing to read in this day and age in our country. So I thank you for taking us down that avenue of the evidence you provided, and I call Michael Mara.
Yeah, a slight reflection on some of that. I don't believe it was tangential at all. I think it's absolutely critical to our understanding
Thank
of
you.
Some of the unintended consequences of legislation, whether it be emergency or properly scrutinised legislation that, that takes place. And I think it would be remiss, convener, for this committee not to make urgent representations to the Justice Minister, given the evidence we've heard today about what action that increase of 40% to 80% in rough terms of the number of people sitting without trial or recourse to justice in prison is totally unacceptable, and something has to be done about it immediately. I suppose my question relates to, and I'm very welcome of the focus on rights and rights to education, excuse me. We heard, you may have heard in the previous panel, some discussion about the risks in the short term of further mutations and strains of the virus that may result in other form closure. I wanted to get your reflections in terms of what some of the consequences of that might be. There was some discussion about digital access. We know that that is far from widespread at the moment, and there are still challenges in that regard. I wonder, Liam, if you could reflect on that.
Yeah, so there's a lot, which I'll highlight just a few. And that digital access one is really important. It came through loud and clear right from the start that young people were to learn online. Slight tangent to that, the virtual learning environment wasn't a very positive one at that particular time. But young people couldn't access it. And it wasn't just as simple as no Wi-Fi, couldn't afford a device, but you've got, for example, mum works from home and has to work all day on the computer, the one computer that's in the household. And we heard stories of young people that were up till 3-4 in the morning doing their work for school because they couldn't do it during the day. On the flip side of that, I think there's rarely positivity, but I'll put it in there, that some young people found that online learning suited them more. So, for example, young care experienced people would have to not attend school because they had caring responsibilities at home. They could engage in their learning throughout the pandemic because they had access to it virtually in a better environment. So that's one element which has kind of got two sides to it, but that does rely on a really robust system that's there. It's an online learning platform or online learning offer that's been co-designed with young people, and young people are part of that process, especially the young people that are going to be using it. Mental health is the other huge one. It comes to time to get educational settings are not just schools, they are a place for young people to go, and it dramatically helps their mental health when they go. And when schools are closed, whilst hubs were provided, they weren't up to standard, young people still felt they couldn't access them, and they couldn't access support when they needed it most, and not just in the wider sphere of mental health, but the simple support of chatting to your guidance teacher in the corridor, that cut off overnight for an extended period of time, and young people didn't have the informal chats with their pals and things like that, which is sounding very dramatic, but it's true that young people are probably never going to go over that they missed that during school. And it came through time and time again, is really important. I think I'll stop there, actually, because I could keep going forever.
I'll come to you in a moment, Megan, if that's OK. The Scottish Government's policy existing at the moment is that every child should have access to a digital device and, you know, the connectivity to provide that. But that's not to be provided, I believe, until the end of this Parliament in its totality. I mean, so would you believe that there's real risk in terms of the lack of provision at the moment if we find another mutation and further school closures?
Categorically, yes.
Yes. Megan, any comment?
I agree on that point, but I am nonetheless aware of the issues facing schools and local authority staff in rolling out devices. It's not a simple matter of handing a child a device. And there were some issues during the pandemic where that happened with no support. And I'm also aware that there is a global shortage of computer chips because everyone suddenly discovered we all need devices. I think Liam made a really important point, which will probably still exist, around broadband connections. And I think we probably have all experienced a thing where we've had to ask someone else in the household to get off a connection, even though we thought we had good connections during the course of the pandemic. And it turned out you couldn't have three online meetings at the same time. So that's always going to be a problem. And I think the experience of children and young people, from what we've heard, and with our young advisors group came and did a session with the committee last year, is that the the experience has been enormously variable with online learning, and that has varied literally from class to class for some young people. They've had excellent online teaching from one teacher and almost nothing from another teacher within the same school. So it's not an issue around specific schools, specific areas, or specific local authorities. It's partly because actually teachers are human beings who had things happening in their lives during the pandemic as well. And I think young people are aware that everyone was going through this and no one was unaffected. There's another group that where Liam's touched on how for some children and young people, online learning was better than school. Now, there should never be a group of children for whom online learning is better than school, because school should be appropriate for all children and young people. And that's a group who, there was some research published by Children Scotland, the National Autistic Society and Scottish Autism a few years ago, and I think Mr Mundell was at the launch of it with me, and it was a good few years ago now, which is on the Not Involved, Not Engaged, Not Included. The website is notengaged.com. And that's a fairly substantial number of children and young people who are absent for school for other than routine childhood illness. They haven't got chickenpox, flu, the cold, or COVID, but they're absent for mental health problems, for anxiety, or because their parents feel that their needs aren't being met and they're not safe at school. Many of those children have autistic spectrum disorders or other similar conditions. And we did hear from directly from families, from children, young people, and also through organisations that support them, like Selvus and Mindroom, that some of those children were suddenly experiencing the first education they'd had from their schools in years. Some of them had been receiving nothing. Some had been receiving as little from the local authority as 1 hour a day. But suddenly, because things were being provided online, through the school, through the local authority, through things like eSchool, that suddenly there was all this education available, and we must not lose that. Even if we were to address some of the issues that prevent that group of children, young people, not attending school, there are still children who can't attend schools for short or long periods, and we've done an amazing amount to build our capacity to support them, and we can't lose that.
So if I can come here, final one, it is very brief. So should this legislation then that we are looking at the moment have a guarantee in it, when we talk about school closures and otherwise, a guarantee about educational access for young people?
Absolutely, it should.
Megan?
In principle, yes. Okay. I think that there needs to be more involvement with children and young people, yep. And also with providers of education on how, what would be achievable, because I wouldn't like to see a promise that can't be kept, yep. Because that's
too
worse
many
than
of those.
Saying nothing.
Yep.
There are far too many of those for children
and
young people.
Well, thank you for your time. I apologise to colleagues that may have still wanted to continue this conversation. It's been very interesting, and thank you both, Megan Farr and Liam Fowley, for your evidence and for your time this morning. We now bring our public part of our committee meeting to an end. I will now suspend the meeting, and can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, which will allow us to consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you again, and have a good morning.